Welcome back to Yahoo Finance Live. Investors have good reason to be concerned about what's happening in the energy sector. Oil prices are at seven-year highs. Natural gas prices have nearly doubled in 6 months. Gas prices along the West Coast are north of $4 a gallon, depending on where you go. Is there any relief in sight here? Natasha Kaneva is the head of global commodity strategy at JPMorgan and joins us now. Natasha, good to see you this morning. I think any conversation on what might happen next for prices really has to start with, how did we get so stretched in these energy markets?
No, absolutely. Well, good morning. My personal opinion is that everything started with China. And as you know, in the case with China, it was coal. So in the case of China, coal accounts for about 70% of the Chinese electricity production. But at the same time, in 2015, China added coal to its oversupplied industries. And since then, production downshifted. So if you look what happened this year in the country is that the Chinese coal production has grew by 6%, but at the same time, power generation from coal has increased, has surged almost 14%, depleting inventories. So what is happening is then, you know, on top of that, you have imports into the country down about 90% as China started importing less and less of the very high energy intensive Newcastle grade coal from Australia. So at the end, what China had to do is turn to global LNG markets. So, and here that's where exactly Europe comes into play, because Europe is a balancing market in the global LNG market, meaning that Europe buys only what is left from the rest of LNG or primary LNG buying markets like Japan and South Korea. So essentially what is happening right now is that as all those regions are entering winter or approaching winter, they're bidding up LNG prices. And the only exit out of the situation is when one of the buyers will stop purchasing. And everybody's looking at Asia and what is happening in Asia, and especially in China. But only 2 weeks ago, Chinese policymakers ordered their energy producing companies to start purchasing energy at any cost. So from that perspective, we do not see any change in the situation. And we do believe that actually higher natural gas prices are here to stay, especially as we enter winter.
So does that mean, Natasha, it's Julie here. So does that mean that once winter has passed, things should moderate?
So yes, again, when we say winter, winter means different things for different countries. Yes, for example, in the case of Russia, winter began 2 weeks earlier than in 2019. Yes, Russia already has its heat turned on, and the same in China. They will be turning the heat very, very soon. So, but overall, winter in general would mean somewhere between October 15th and March 15th, meaning that when winter is over, it's over only by mid-March. And by that time, we do expect that the situation should improve. But we have a long winter ahead of us. Hopefully winter will be warm. But again, you know, it's a global market. So what we need winter to be warm in all regions, not just in China or in Europe, but in Japan, South Korea, and in the United States for that matter as well.
Natasha, frame this for us. If we do get the bad winter, which we hope we don't get here in the States or really around the world, but if we do get a worse than expected winter in the U.S., where do heating oil prices go?
So sky's the limit. Pretty much we're dealing with theoretical prices, yes, at this point, because as you absolutely correctly pointed out, everything is at record high levels and we just don't see the release valve. So the only option is for the demand destruction to start taking place. Yes. And we already see that. And that's exactly where the link with the oil prices is, because the natural gas prices are so high that the consumers are just balking. They're saying, listen, we cannot use it. Let's switch to some other sources. And that's exactly what is happening in oil. But overall, you know, Henry Hub right now, it's about $6. We absolutely can make a case that it will double from here. So you could be looking at something, you know, close to $10-$12. $20 for Henry Hub, absolutely. If you're having another winter storm, similarly to what we had in Texas last year, we cannot even put a price on the European natural gas prices at this point. So it's everything is theoretical.
I mean, Natasha, holy crap. Pardon me, but like I have to set my thermostat really low this winter. This is pretty dire stuff that you're talking about here. Is there, and it sounds like you think that there's nothing really that's going to change the equation for the foreseeable future.
Warm winter, definitely. And again, winter by mid-October.
Is there anything under producers or policymakers' control? Obviously, they can't, you know, decide whether there's going to be a warm winter. But is there anything, whether we're talking about OPEC or various governments in terms of releases of reserves? I mean, is there anything potential that could change things?
I think it's we need to differentiate between gas markets and oil markets. In the case of the gas markets, you know, clearly you saw the statements last week from Russia that Russia can ship a little bit more of gas. We believe that it may be a little bit too little and a little bit too late to change the situation. So in the case of the gas markets, we believe no, not likely. So it had to be a demand destruction. In the case of the oil markets, you're absolutely correct. OPEC can step in and increase production. So far, they refuse to do that. We personally believe that that was the right argument, because in the case of energy prices, you know, clearly it's disrupting supplies, but at the same time, demand could be destroyed as well. Yes, and that's, I think, what OPEC has been watching very closely, especially what is happening in the case of China. Yes, they're shutting down industrial production. You can see all those smelters, aluminum smelters, being shut down. So from that perspective, it means there are less trucks, yes, driving around this aluminum, and less diesel being consumed. So we're watching that very, very closely. But, you know, eventually, of course, if the prices get to a particular level, OPEC can step in and do something. Biden administration says that they're ready to release, or they were considering releasing about 60 million barrels of oil. That should theoretically equal to about $7 to $10 lower in the oil price. So, yes, there are levers and tools that policymakers could do. So we're watching very closely.
Natasha, I know you're not an economist, but I mean, to hear some of these, where heating oil prices can go, how damaging could this be to the economic recovery?
A short answer, it is damaging. It could be, you know, through the direct destruction on industrial production. That's exactly what is happening in China. We see signs of that happening in Europe. We already saw a couple announcements of fertilizers plants being shut down, ammonia plant being shut down, a couple of the smelters curtailing operations and so on. In the case of China, it's, you know, clearly more extensive, and you see this already, yes, in the headlines. So this is just direct destruction of industrial production, but at the same time, there's something to be said about inflation as well, yes, because you absolutely see this in the numbers, that it's picking up, and, you know, clearly energy prices are a big part of that. So it is, by all means, it is damaging.
Well, all I can say is let's hope for 75 degrees and blue skies this winter. We'll leave it there. Natasha Kaneva, the head of global commodity strategy at JPMorgan. Good to see you.